Minister, that concludes the members' business debate on the Women's Lead Committee, and we now move on to the next item of business. The next item of business is a members' business debate on motion 23613 in the name of Monica Lennon on Scotland's drugs death crisis. This debate will be concluded without any questions being put, and so will those members who wish to speak in the debate please put an R in the chat box now, and I call on Monica Lennon to open the debate.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm grateful to colleagues across the Chamber who signed the motion and made it possible for this debate to happen today. I'm also grateful to the members who will be speaking in the debate, and I look forward to listening to their contributions. Since joining this Parliament in 2016, this is the third members' business motion on substance misuse that I have brought forward for debate. The first debate was in 2017, the second was in 2019, and here we are again debating Scotland's drug death crisis. Our drug death rate is now the highest in Europe. Presiding Officer, words don't feel adequate in response to this humanitarian crisis. Recovery activists in Scotland have been telling us politicians for years that you keep talking, we keep dying. You keep talking, we keep dying. And tragically, and to our collective shame, they are right. Just before Christmas, following a 6-month publication delay, it was finally confirmed that 1,264 people died from drug-related deaths in 2019. That's in 1 year alone. It's the highest on record. The loss of life has doubled in a decade. I want to put on record my condolences to everyone who has lost a loved one. Behind these grim statistics are real people. They were our mothers and fathers, husbands, wives and partners, sons and daughters, grandchildren, nephews, nieces and cousins. They were our friends, neighbours and colleagues. In their memory, and to show respect to all who have died, I would be grateful if colleagues would join me in a minute's silence of remembrance. Thank you, colleagues. Presiding Officer, we have agreed many times in this Parliament that these deaths are preventable. I welcomed Angela Constance to her post as Drugs Policy Minister last month, and I want to do so again today. Angela Constance has been tasked with a critical job, and I know she is determined to use the time remaining in this parliamentary session to maximum effect. I also want to acknowledge the work undertaken by Joe Fitzpatrick in his role as in the broader portfolio of public health, wellbeing and sport. It is right, I believe, that Joe left his post to allow for fresh leadership. However, I do want to put on record that his sincerity was never in doubt. And I hope the positive changes that he made, including the work to reduce stigma, I hope that these are built on. The First Minister herself, however, has admitted that the Scottish Government's record and response to Scotland's drug death crisis is unacceptable and inexcusable. She's appointed a minister with a very specific and narrow responsibility for drugs policy, and this is very welcome, but it must be backed up with hard cash, a step change across government. That means no more silo working, no more passing the buck, and no more wrong doors. The response to this humanitarian crisis needs a comprehensive public health approach, and for person-centred support to be available 24/7. That has to be both for people who live with substance misuse themselves, but also crucially for their families. And on that note, I was pleased to see this week Scottish families affected by drugs and alcohol receive funding for the Families as Lifesavers project. Lack of money and resource for statutory and third sector services hasn't been the only driver behind Scotland's increasing drug deaths, but it is a major factor. Services are running on shoestring budgets, rehab beds have closed, including on the First Minister's own doorstep, and it has been left to friends and family to pick up the pieces too many times. As a minimum, £20 million is required right now for residential rehab, as an absolute minimum. I spoke to Anne-Marie Ward, the CEO of Faces and Voices of Recovery UK this morning. Favour UK gave a report with 23 recommendations to the Scottish Government over a year ago, and I'm pleased to hear that the Minister will meet with Favour in a few weeks' time. But I asked Anne-Marie Ward, what does the new Minister need to do? And she said, help people get well. Give people the opportunities to get well. Give them the opportunities to get off drugs. The reality is, Presiding Officer, that too many people are met with a boarded up door or a waiting list as long as you're Adam. Last year, before the lockdown in March, I went to Castle Craig Residential Rehab in the Borders and also Abbeycare in North Lanarkshire, and I met staff who'd previously been service users themselves 15, 20 years ago when they had felt at rock bottom, were able to go to their GP, ask for help, and in a matter of days they were able to enter residential treatment and rehab. In Scotland, over the years, that opportunity has been available to fewer and fewer people. Everything that needs to be said about what a public health response to this emergency should encompass, an emergency that's rooted in poverty, trauma and inequality, has already been said in debates like this and elsewhere many, many times. So I'm not going to repeat it all now. The answers are already on the Minister's desk. I would be grateful, Presiding Officer, in closing, if the Minister could outline what immediate action she has taken already and will take in the weeks ahead to ensure that there is a full spectrum of harm reduction, recovery and prevention interventions. We owe it to those who have died and those who are fighting for their lives today to finally treat this emergency with the seriousness and the budget it deserves. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I now call Ruth Maguire to be followed by Neil Fidley.
Thank you, Officer. Can I start by thanking Monica Lennon for securing this debate? And if I may, I'll also take the opportunity to welcome Minister Angela Constance to her new role. 3/4 of all drug-related deaths were in 5 health board areas: Greater Glasgow and Clyde, Lanarkshire, Lothian, Tayside and Ayrshire and Arran. And Ayrshire and Arran was one of the health board areas with the largest increases of drug deaths over the last decade. Far too many lives lost, friends, families, neighbours, important lives, lives that matter. Presiding Officer, I do think it's really important to recognise that there is a lot of good work being done by good people doing their very best, although there is more for all of us to do, particularly politicians and policymakers. Now, we know that for complex issues, a person-centred approach has the best chance of being successful. Something that's truly person-centred will meet people where they are, will recognise barriers in their way and remove them. and it will also understand and act on the fact that substance addiction is a symptom of wider difficulties, and it will identify and provide support for those too. Person-centred can't just be words on a policy document or an action plan. It must be the reality for our citizens who need help. Our actions and the experience of our people and their families requiring assistance must match those fine words. I have raised the matter before of punitive sanction regimes existing in treatment services. Now, I want to acknowledge that sanctions in treatment and recovery is not advocated by the Scottish Government. However, it was and may well remain the experience for people trying to access help. I recognise the need for local flexibility and responses. However, the sharing of knowledge, skills, procedures and processes that work across Scotland must increase and improve at pace. There's good life-saving work happening. If housing officers in North Ayrshire can save lives administering the naloxone, and they have, then that should be possible right across Scotland. If drop-in access and same-day prescribing can be offered and work in one part of the country, then what on earth can be the logic, reason or justification for that not being available to all people who need it? I know that outcomes and measures are important to policymakers, and I would suggest that if it remains easier to buy a dangerous street drug than it is to get help and support, we should consider that a measure of failure. Lives are being saved and services are being delivered now by kind, compassionate workers and volunteers who will be in pain and stressed at the tragic loss of life. Importantly, we also have in our communities people who are in recovery, who are supporting their peers to have hope and purpose in their lives. Let's listen to them, all of them, not just the people and organisations who are already plugged into the system and are frequently consulted and engaged with, not just the people and the organisations who speak the language of policymakers. Let's listen to voices that are challenging, uncomfortable voices that push us all and show us the reality for our citizens, not just the policy intentions in our strategies and action plans. But most importantly, let's act with urgency and immediacy, the same urgency and immediacy to save lives that we did at the start of this pandemic. We've shown what can be done. We know what needs to happen to save lives. And frankly, shame on us all if we don't get on with it. Presiding Officer.
Thank you. I now call Neil Findlay to be followed by Stuart McMillan.
Thanks, Presiding Officer. And can I congratulate Monica Lennon on bringing forward the debate and welcome the Minister to our post. Of course, the debate should have been held in government time because this is our national shame, the drugs deaths crisis. It's a collective failure of government, of public bodies, political leaders over the entire duration of the Parliament's existence and beyond, of course, accelerated in the last decade to a place where we have the worst drugs deaths record in the developed world. I've made speech after speech in debates like this for years, and the only thing that changes is the situation gets worse. So in the short time I've got, I'm only going to make positive suggestions in the hope that the Minister, indeed any Minister, might actually take on board some of what I suggest, all of which is based on speaking to friends and family and neighbours and constituents who've either gone through addiction, their family member has gone through addiction, or who work in the field. So first of all, can we agree that the war on drugs has been an abject failure? There are more drugs and more deaths than ever in our history, so it's time for a new approach. That the impact of drugs is a class issue, because the greatest impact is on poorest communities, and without a serious concerted change of government policy that sees these communities endure a disproportionately high level of public investment, then change will not come. While a pharmacological intervention to substance misuse can be required, it's the socio-economic factors that drive substance misuse and drug-related deaths that have to be addressed. Can we agree that we should stop jailing people because of their illness and address their conditions through treatment with a range of options available based on their wants and needs? Can we agree that we stop discharging people from prison or hospital onto the streets with no support, no treatment or care plan, no home and no hope? These are people who fall out of the system and end up dead. Can we agree that the current services available to people who want to end their drugs use is completely inadequate, and we need comprehensive services to meet different needs? Of course, methadone might be part of the solution, but for many more, they want to be illicit and prescription drug-free. That is their objective, and we need services to allow that to happen. That we need a human rights approach that is fully embedded within all services, and an acknowledgement that rights holders can hold duty bearers to account. That services for cocaine and for the benzos crisis are nowhere near adequate and must be addressed as a national priority. That we follow the example of progressive police and crime commissioners across the UK who have been using a wide range of measures under the same legal restrictions as Scotland to reduce deaths, addiction and improve public health and divert people from prosecution. Can we agree that we can reinstate every single cut that has been made and more to the drugs and alcohol budget and stop insulting the memory of those who have died by claiming there have not been any cuts? And yes, given the crisis, ring-fence that money so it cannot be diverted to the worried well. Can we agree that the government can act to end the police involvement with the Glasgow overdose prevention van and will do so, and that such facilities be rolled out in communities where people are dying? That we hold to account the bodies and agencies who have been funded year on year to help address the situation, and if they have failed, take the funding from them and fund new effective provision ensuring accountability and appropriate governance arrangements. Can we understand what we are spending money on and what the cost of treatment is and the real number of people accessing treatments? And can we agree that we undertake a full assessment of local needs based on accurate data? And finally, will the Minister agree to initiate an immediate independent review to look at the experience of decriminalisation of all drugs in other countries where they've had similar problems to Scotland? Presiding Officer, I have so much more to say that I could say, but no time to do it. But I do say to the Minister, my door is open. I will work with her on any of this. This is far too important to be a party political bun fight, and I know that there are colleagues who want to speak in this debate who would work with her on this as well.
Thank you very much. I call Stuart McMillan, to be followed by Brian Whittle.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Presiding Officer, at the outset, I want to thank Monica Lennon for bringing this debate to the Chamber. And I note the motion talks about Central Scotland. I'm not going to focus my comments on Central Scotland. It's not my region, not my area. I'm going to focus my comments either on Inverclyde or about the Scotland. I'd like to remind colleagues of my register of interests as a board member of a local addiction service called Moving On Inverclyde. I want to welcome Angela Constance, firstly, to her new role, and I'd like to wish her well in that. It's certainly a challenging role that she has. I would also want to thank Joe Fitzpatrick for his efforts and the creation of the Drugs Deaths Task Force, which I'm sure will actually prove to be a vital addition to dealing with this crisis as we move forward. The latest figures for 2019 must be a wake-up call for every politician, but also for society. There are tough decisions that need to be taken. The souls of 1,264 people that need to force every single one of us, every single politician, to look at every policy and also every delivery model to see if it's actually doing enough. Also, 1,264 deaths need to tell us that we must look at the gaps in policy areas. That's essential for that to happen. Now, I stress to colleagues that this isn't it's not a constitutional point, because some of the gaps and some of the policy gaps might already be devolved, but some might also be reserved. But fundamentally, every policy area must be on the table for discussion. Inverclyde is sadly behind Dundee and Glasgow, respectively, with regards to drugs deaths. 33 of my constituents died in 2019. And that was a near 50% increase on 2018. Now that cannot continue. And looking at the three areas with the most deaths clearly highlights that social justice is a key issue as to why there are many drugs deaths in Scotland. Poverty, deprivation, unemployment, industrial decline are reasons behind the increase in many of the drugs deaths. Not all, but many. It's a fact that many more deaths are now of older drug users. And as the BBC wrote on the 15th of December, and I'll quote, during the 1980s and 90s, there was a significant increase in problem drug users in Scotland, which peaked about 20 years ago. They also continued by this. There is now an ageing population of drug addicts, mainly men, who have been using heroin for decades. We already know this, but it clearly needs to be highlighted time and time again. And I genuinely believe that if we can sort out some of the social justice inequalities, we'll actually give drug users and communities a better chance going forward. I'd like to see a few things considered to try and deal with this national crisis. First of all, Inverclyde is not included in the naloxone pilot that's underway. That currently has been utilised by Dundee, Glasgow and Falkirk. All three areas will have differing health board areas, but I genuinely think that Inverclyde should also be included because of where we currently are. Secondly, I genuinely believe that funding for third sector organisations that are more successful in helping people with drug addictions should be considered for direct funding. Thirdly, I think the increase in people going to residential detox facilities is absolutely important. I've spoken to many people about that in the past. Fourthly, the introduction of the drug consumption facilities are something that's absolutely crucial. Both Emma Harper, MSP, and myself met with Peter Krikant outside of the Parliament only a few weeks ago, and I became even more convinced that this activity will actually help many more people and communities. And fifthly, I generally believe that a thorough analysis of the local EDPs is essential. I know that Inverclyde has a major change of direction over the last 18 months, and I'm hopeful that that change will actually save more lives going forward. But saying also, there are many more things I would actually want to discuss, but I know time is short, so I would be keen to discuss with the Minister directly if her diary allows that to happen. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. I call Brian Whittle to be followed by Emma Harper.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Can I thank Monica Lennon for giving us the opportunity to discuss this continuing crisis in Scotland again. Now, death from drug and alcohol misuse is a crisis in Scotland. The current rate is the worst in the world per capita and is three times that of the rest of the UK. Drug death rate has more than doubled in a decade from 2008 to 2018 and shows no sign of slowing down. From the outset, I want to highlight there are two sides to this issue. Treatment for those caught in addiction and then creating an environment where addiction is avoided. And I specifically want to speak about the link between deprivation and addiction. It's something I've been working on for a considerable period of time, and children born in the most deprived areas are three times more likely to die before they're 25. This is an undoubtable correlation with an increased alcohol and drug abuse coupled with suicides. Now, I joined the Scottish Affairs Committee down in Westminster in 2019 for their investigation into Scotland's drug issue, and they concluded that deprivation itself does not directly cause addiction. The links between poverty and drugs misuse are complex. The main mechanisms that are described as credible links between deprivation and problem drug use are weak family bonds, psychological discomfort and personal distress, low employment opportunities, and few community resources. Of course, once someone has a drug problem, they also have more limited means to escape that poverty. The chances of obtaining paid employment is much reduced. Having a criminal record or a lack of an employment history and the stigma of having or having had substance of a problem all play a part to this. So to me, it stands to reason that resource should be allocated prior to the addiction. This has to be surely the most cost-effective investment. Simply put, we know where these areas are, so we can ensure the solutions and investment is targeted. If there are fewer community resources in these areas, then develop those resources to fit the communities. The Drug Forum found that poverty is also significantly connected with personal factors that increase the likelihood of problem drug use, ACEs, and poor engagement by or outcomes from educational services, poor engagement by health services, early engagement by criminal justice system, imprisonment, and homelessness. According to the conclusions from the conference, A Matter of Life and Death, at which there were some 110 organisations associated with prevention and treatment of drug and alcohol use, some of the main causes of drug and alcohol misuse included marginalisation and exclusion, lack of social structure, poor relationships, lack of protective factors, self-medication associated with masking pain and previous trauma, stigma, self-deprecation, barriers to achievement, and homelessness. Deprivation and inequality make the above more acute, leading to a more likely situation where there is a less likely access to quality treatment and help, or a lack of access to general community services, an unmet complex health need, a lack of effective support structure. So for me, I think if we look at during the period of 2008 to 2018, the number of rehabilitation beds was drastically cut from 352 in 22 facilities to less than 70 in 3 facilities. This has to be reversed and quickly, which is a key ask from the Scottish Conservatives. I think we have to invest in rehabilitation hubs, which pull together the resources of both the NHS Drug and Alcohol Partnerships and the third sector. As others have mentioned, the third sector is fragmented and underfunded. Organisations spend far too much time scrapping with each other for the limited funding pots. Many of the hardest to reach in our society who are caught in the scourge of addiction are from the most deprived areas. They're also the least likely to engage with services within a medical facility. They are more likely, however, to work with third sector agencies in the community with whom they can identify and take the time to build a trusting relationship. I can say from interaction with services such as recovery enterprises in my area that their work is the very best route to the most vulnerable, but they do it on a shoestring budget. Once that relationship is created, then there is potential to offer medical interventions on the premises from healthcare professionals, welfare officers, housing officers, etc. In other words, bring the services to them. Within these hubs, there should be the option for rehabilitation beds, cafes, and professional advice. Mental health services should be offered as an integral part of rehabilitation services. With drug misuse so prevalent in prison communities, pathways from prison into the community have to be created. And then increasing needle exchange programmes with a view to reducing HIV and eradicating hepatitis C. Deputy Presiding Officer, these are actions all within the competence of the Scottish Government, and we know from those in the front line that they can have significant impact on addiction. We can't hide behind constitutional disagreements. The calls for change in the legal framework, I think, would be more viable if we were prepared to make use of the substantial powers which they currently have at hand. It will require significant resource and attention. This focus is long overdue, and as Neil Findlay said, there are many of us who have consistently been involved in these debates who would put party politics aside and work with the Minister to help develop a strategy. Please, Minister, take us up on those offers. Deputy Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much. I call Emma Harper to be followed by Alex Cole-Hamilton.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I welcome the opportunity to speak in this debate, and I thank Monica Lennon on securing it. I also welcome Angela Constance on her appointment as Drugs Minister, and I look forward to meeting her to explore options to address issues of drugs misuse in rural areas like Dumfries and Galloway in my South Scotland region. I have no doubt that her government experience and prior work will be hugely beneficial in this new role, and I also thank Joe Fitzpatrick for his work previously too. I agree with the motion and the government that drug-related death figures published in December are unacceptable, and we do need to move at pace with new and innovative person-centred approaches to better deal with problem drug use in Scotland. Presiding Officer, as Deputy Convener of the Health and Sport Committee, I had the opportunity to participate in the Scottish Affairs Committee inquiry into the drug-related deaths in 2019. All of the witnesses in the inquiry said that urgent reform is needed to solve the issue of drug deaths in Scotland. The inquiry also heard from experts from Portugal, Germany and Canada. This was to examine the evidence from international examples of countries that are taking a progressive public health response and not a punitive approach like jailing people that Neil Findlay describes. progressive public health approach is what we need to tackling harmful drug use. And in doing so, we found at the committee inquiry that levels of drug deaths and addiction in these countries have reduced significantly, including as much as 40% in Canada. The inquiry recommended that personal amounts of drugs should be decriminalised and that the UK government must urgently bring forward legislation that will allow for the devolution of power to the Scottish Parliament to allow it to deliver its own approaches, including establishing safe consumption facilities in Scotland. Such reforms would, for example, prevent people such as Peter Crikant, who I met outside Parliament before Christmas, as Stuart McMillan mentioned. And all Peter wants to do is help support people who have problem drug use that's causing them harm. The Scottish Affairs Committee findings remain important, and I'm keen to hear from the Minister regarding her thoughts on the inquiry recommendations, especially since the UK government has completely ignored them all. It would be good if all governments worked together to save lives. Presiding Officer, I spoke with Graeme Clark today from D&G Alcohol and Drugs Partnership, and Graeme described a number of actions already in place locally and nationally. Graeme and his team should be thanked for all their work, and this includes the National Naloxone Programme and the distribution of take-home naloxone kits, which are used to prevent fatal overdoses of heroin-based drugs, and then the nasal naloxone, which is available to Police Scotland and drug support groups. Graeme also described assertive outreach following non-fatal overdoses to engage, to treat and to offer support with housing, with food, with social security, access to CAMHS, recovery cafes, recovery communities and even apprenticeships and independent living. All of this sounds to me like it is joined up working and not silo working. This is all good work. The Scottish Government have implemented the Drug and Alcohol Information System, which commenced on the 1st of December 2020 and provides key information on the impact of drug and alcohol treatment services. All these actions that are being taken to address issues, especially stigma, is really, really important. That's one of the actions that Graeme and his team have taken forward as well in Dumfries and Galloway. Tackling stigma is a hugely important issue. In summing up, Presiding Officer, I would ask for a commitment from the Minister that any policy approach moving forward will ensure that rural parts of Scotland are absolutely considered and listened to and included. I want to welcome the swift action of the First Minister and the Drug Policy Minister that they have taken on this issue since her recent appointment. And this is what Graeme Clark finally said earlier to me today. If we can get help to those most at risk, and not just at a time of crisis, but through recovery and support, that is what will reduce the numbers of deaths of our fellow Scottish citizens. I look forward to supporting progress and to achieve better outcomes in the future. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And I call on Alex Cole-Hamilton to be followed by Bob Doris.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. I'm very grateful to Monica Lennon for securing time for this debate, and I too welcome the new Drugs Minister to her place. It is a desperately important role, and she knows this. She knows the figures. We have had record numbers of deaths for years. 4,253 people have died since the start of this Parliament due to drug-related death. A drug-related death rate that is more than 3.5 times that of England and Wales, or indeed anywhere else in the whole of Europe. Scotland is quite literally off the charts. There has long been a fatalism in the discussions around Scotland's drug death crisis. These people are not well. There is little anyone could have done. It's the unavoidable, inevitable legacy that Stuart McMillan referred to of ageing drug users and the so-called train spotting generation. But those excuses are cold comfort to the families of 1,264 people who died in 2018, cold comfort to the families of the 76 people aged under 24 who died that year. That's doubled in 2 years. And cold comfort to the families of the 677 people aged between 25 and 45. These are people dying 3, 4, 5 decades earlier. Every death is preventable. At the outset of this Parliament, ministers too were describing this as a legacy of misuse which stretches back decades. At the very same moment, they chose to make and delivered a devastating 23% cut to drug and alcohol partnership budgets. That totaled £1.3 million per year in our nation's capital alone. Planning officer services and expertise that people relied upon were surrendered, and that impact is still being felt. And you need only look at the selfless acts of private citizens like Peter Krykamp, unwilling to see that gap go unfilled. That cut was preventable. Indeed, on the afternoon that Scottish budget was passed, Willie Rennie was the only one to appeal for a rethink. The tragic truth is Scottish ministers didn't see drug reform as a vote winner. Kenny McCaskill, Justice Secretary for 7 years and at the time of the independence referendum, acknowledged it. Writing in 2017, he said, "Silence may have been understandable when the referendum was going on. Now it's simply cowardly as tragedy unfolds." Silence may have been understandable when the referendum was ongoing. Tell that to the families. It is time to put the recovery first. I'm asking the new drugs minister to not shy away from the mistakes of the past, but to own them. I know, and I like Angela Constance. I'm confident she will. We need to be able to talk openly about what is missing if we are to talk openly about what now needs to be done. And I'm asking her to look again at our long-held proposals, including those government voted down last January. Look again at the Portuguese model. We are leagues behind our European partners, best practice, and what is now mainstream evidence that works. We need political support for the principle of diversion for people caught with drugs for personal use and for those routes to be created, and imprisonment in these cases should, of course, be ceased. Look at what can be done through the Lord's Advocate's powers and at the pilots in Thames Valley, North Wales and Durham. Plan for a Scotland-wide network of heroin-assisted treatment. Look at why families are having to self-fund recovery services for residential rehab, and commit to protect drug partnership budgets going forward. Of course, I want to see change at a UK level too. For example, it is a matter of public record that I support extending the involvement of the Scottish Government in the development of a UK-wide policy framework on drugs. But this government can't use the Constitution to avoid the conclusion of the Scottish Affairs Committee. There is undoubtedly more that this government can do. And I look forward to working with the new minister in her role over the coming months. Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much. And I call Bob Dorris to be followed by John Finney.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And can I begin by thanking Monica Lynn for securing this debate this afternoon. It is both crucial and timely, and can also welcome Angela Constance to her post. Look forward to working with Angela going forward, and thank Joe Fitzpatrick for his service over the years. My constituency, as others have shared about their local communities, have been absolutely blighted by drug-related deaths over far too many years, and the numbers continue to increase. It's a real scarring effect. I would also note it doesn't just, it's not just about the tragic loss of loved ones, but it's about the consequences and impact on families that are left behind that last a lifetime. But I want to use this debate as an opportunity to once again put on record my belief that we need far more rehab facilities and more beds in Scotland, something I've called for in the Parliament on several occasions. And I will return to that, but before I say more about that, can acknowledge that there are many pathways to recovery, and I welcome various community supports that exist. I'll give a special mention to Cisco, who are very active in my constituency, and I commend the Minister meeting with Cisco, with myself and Anna Bolton MP, hopefully in the weeks ahead. I also welcome the heroin assisted treatment that exists in Glasgow. I know that it's relatively small scale, and I hope that can be expanded and rolled out across the country, and acknowledge the substantial efforts of Peter Krykamp, who's already been mentioned in relation to overdose prevention and safe consumption facility in Glasgow. Safe consumption facilities save lives, and it is clear that if drugs legislation were altered or devolved to this Parliament, NHS Greater Glasgow would stand ready to deliver a purpose-built service. That's not a constitutional point. I'm just merely stating that NHS Greater Glasgow would remain ready to roll out a service. That said, however, Presiding Officer, I look forward to hearing from the Minister about how we can resolve the current legal deadlock, which puts a man with a van who simply wishes to save lives at risk of conviction. That just doesn't seem right to me. But I did say I wanted to look at residential rehab, and it's simply not possible. We've got a range of treatment options and supports for those living with addiction. It's simply not possible to have that with the extent of rehab beds and facilities we have in Scotland just now. The Scottish Government's only Short Life Working Group, via the task force, has shown there are only 365 beds in Scotland, of which 100 are for people not normally resident in Scotland. And look at who's in those beds. 36.8% are self-funded, 27% through Social Security and charities, 22% from private insurance, only 13% from alcohol and drug partnerships. That just doesn't seem right, Presiding Officer. Of the 1,384 estimated starts for those in rehab beds in the last year that we have figures for, 830 were people who were normally resident in Scotland. That's in contrast with 40,000 alcohol and drug treatment starts over that same period. So of the 40,000 treatment starts for alcohol and drug treatment, only 830 looked at a rehab as part of that, the treatment options. Apart, that's 5% of all referrals. In Europe, it's roughly around 11% in treatment options. So at the very least, we need a doubling of rehab opportunities in Scotland, at the least. The Short Life Working Group also said a review of evidence in 2017 found that although seen as expensive, residential rehab initial costs are at a large extent offset by reductions in subsequent healthcare and criminal justice costs. I don't mention that in relation to economic argument for rehab beds, but it's more about people who have healthcare issues and addiction issues shouldn't have to go through the criminal justice system time and again, and too many of them, unfortunately, ending up dead. But there are positive signs of change, not fast enough, quite clearly. The new prison to rehab pathway for those leaving custody is in its early days, a £150,000 investment, but only 8 people have been through that service so far. It has to be upscaled and rolled out wider. I was reading about the Scottish Recovery Consortium, who are developing a mixed community and rehab model aimed for those who have survived overdoses or are at high risk of overdosing in the first place. I don't have any numbers around that, Minister. I would like to hear much more about that and how that can be upscaled. And when we look at the success of rehab, the government's own work in relation to this was only able to get 5 facilities to give them figures. For those completing rehab periods for their stays, that range between 24% completing rehab and 88% at another facility, a dramatic range. It was also unclear the length of time that individuals were staying within facilities, and it was unclear about the additional community support pathways that existed depending on where individuals were. But what was clear from Phoenix Futures was that 92% of those in residential rehab had significant emotional and mental health issues. We got a wraparound help and support, of which residential rehab would just be part of that solution. And finishing off, Presiding Officer, because I know we are pushed for time, I can see that now, my apologies, there are still many gaps in information from the mapping exercise the Scottish Government conducted on residential rehab. But we don't have the time to wait to do a second mapping exercise. We have to upscale now. We have to put significant additional residential rehab facilities in place now, perhaps nationally, funded nationally, and allow alcohol and drug partnerships to bid for beds in those national facilities if required. That national network would be put in place. And if ADPs are not referring those who would benefit from that treatment, we have to ask why, and we have to make it happen. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. And our last open debate speaker is John Finney.
Thank you very much indeed, Presiding Officer. And can I join with others in thanking Monica Lennon for bringing this important debate, also thanking Joe Fitzpatrick, the former minister, and welcoming Angela Constance to what clearly is a challenging post that I'm sure she's up to. Now, to quote from various bits of the motion, the national public health crisis is mentioned in the motion, and it's unquestionably that. And as others have said, this isn't the preserve of urban central belt. It affects rural communities in a devastating way too, and every life lost is a tragedy. More action can be done at national and local level, the motion says. Well, undoubtedly, but of course, as other officers said, there has been great work done. The problem, to my mind, is that drug deaths are not a priority for many of our constituents. Many of them sadly see deaths as an inevitable consequence of the actions of some unclean criminal underclass. Now, we all know that that's not only deeply offensive, but it's also wholly inaccurate. But it does play into the wider public discourse about this debate, so I welcome the element in the motion that we're addressing stigma, as a number of the contributors have already done. Also, the question of funding access to residential establishment must be worded. Well, of course, widened. Well, of course, but I'm concerned about some of the discussion in this in some quarters, certainly not the author of the motion, that this quaint notion of securing people in residential establishments out of sight, out of mind. Residential treatment is important, but it's one of a range of treatments, and they should all be available and should all be properly funded. This is all about treatment. This is all about recovery. It's all about ongoing support. It's about understanding addiction and understanding the support for lapses that will inevitably occur. Now, I was co-signatory at a letter that Patrick Harvey co-signed a letter with me that we wrote to the Land Advocate about the case that many have alluded to of a gentleman in Glasgow. And whilst I didn't expect a detailed response in respect to that particular situation, what I commended to the Land Advocate was the practice that his predecessors had adopted in relation to the public interest approach when instructing prosecutors regarding instances that were contrary to the clear legal position of the day. And aside to the situation of consensual homosexual sex, predecessors were rightly lauded for adopting a bolder emphasis on prosecuting in the public interest, and I commended that same approach. I got a reply from the Lord Advocate yesterday stating that he couldn't comment on that specific case, obviously, but he had published prosecuting guidelines in relation to the use of naloxone, which some have talked of earlier, and he said that I would add, it will be clear to you that I have described as quite different from providing a statement of prosecution policy and general application. Well, I'm sorry, it's not quite clear. I think it does create evidence that should be built on. This is very frustrating because of the limited time we have, but what I would like to say is our obligations as legislators is to understand if there's a legislative problem that needs to be addressed. There is a legislative problem. It's the UK drugs legislation. It's focused on the long-discredited phony war on drugs. And there was a headline in a satirical magazine in the 70s that said, drugs wins drugs war. It's part of the problem, and it's certainly not the solution. It is reserved. And you know, if people want to think of this as a constitutional issue, that's fair enough they can. This is not what it's about for me. We should be trying our very best to address a situation of legislation as a problem, and I believe it is. Then we must legislate, pushing boundaries and indeed the competence of the Parliament. Or what we can do is just sit and await the next series of grim figures. Now, we rightly mark the deaths for silence. I suspect I'm not alone in wanting to scream out in anguish at the situation we find ourselves in. My time's up. I wish the Minister well, and of course, with others, I'm happy to work with her. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And I now call on the Minister to respond to the debate, Angela Constance.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Every day in Scotland, three of our fellow citizens, someone's brother, someone's sister, someone's son or daughter, dies from a drug-related death. And I want to put on record my condolences to all families who have lost a loved one. These deaths are both tragic and preventable. So I want to thank Monica Lennon for securing this critical debate, and also to thank all members who have participated for their contribution, commitment and suggestions. And I will indeed be taking them up on some of their offers. I'm also happy to meet with Stuart McMillan, Emma Harper, Bob Doris, and have many meetings already arranged with MSPs, councillors and MPs across the party political divide. And I am crystal clear that to save lives, we need to do more, we need to do it better, and we need to do it faster. And as a pragmatist, I will always focus on what I can do as opposed to what I can't do. The first thing I did as Minister for Drug Policy was to meet those with lived experience. and this will not be a one-off event. Ensuring the voice of real-life experience informs every step of our journey was crucial in work that I was involved in when I was last in government, social security, homelessness, child poverty. And those with lived and living experience and their families will be at the very heart of our national mission. And I'm glad that Monica Lennon recognised the support that we've given to the Families as Lifesavers project. Because I will hear from those families who have received too little, too late. I will hear from parents who are worried sick about the phone call or that knock at the door. And I will hear from those survivors who are in recovery or in treatment. And I am absolutely determined to find the best way to reach out to those who are currently living with drug addiction and are not in treatment nor engaged with services. Because being in treatment is a protective factor. And my focus will be in getting more people into treatment that is right for them, particularly those who are hard to reach and most at risk. And we need to remove the barriers to treatment and the obstacles to people to remaining in treatment. Therefore, Presiding Officer, I want to build a consensus within and out with this Parliament that is not necessarily comfortable, cosy, and most certainly not complacent, but is about challenging ourselves and each other on the basis of what works. And I will indeed learn from experience and evidence and research, whether that's at a UK level, a European level, or an international level. You need a spectrum of services and approaches that responds to this public health emergency, reduces harms, and promotes the right route to recovery for each individual. Nothing less than the right treatment at the right time. And we need a culture of change and a culture of compassion to ensure services are responsive, flexible, and people-centred. And we don't need to wait around for evidence. We can gather evidence in action. And as well as doing things differently, like Ruth Maguire, I want to scale up work that has promise. The Drugs Death Task Force, who the First Minister and I met with this week, has tested and led the way on life-saving emergency treatment such as naloxone. I have met a father who told me that naloxone saved his son time and time again, and the Scottish Ambulance Service are doing great work to increase distribution of this tool on the front line. But I'm also acutely aware that 60% of those who died from a drug death in Dundee died alone. They were using drugs alone and they died alone. We need to scale up pilots to ensure also that if someone presents to services with an overdose, that we not only save their life, but we offer them treatment immediately. Because we know that more than half of those who die from a drug-related death have a history of overdose. So we need to roll out with pace work previously done by the task force on new standards of care and treatment so that there is equity of access across the country. And I hear what Stuart McMillan says with that regard. We need a presumption of family involvement and that individuals, all individuals, must have good treatment options. We need better treatments for polydrug misuse and benzodiazepine dependence, as well as ensuring prescribing practice is effective in keeping people alive. And Ruth Maguire is quite correct to say that people should never feel punished for seeking help. All the individuals on the task force, including those with lived experience, have given of their time and talents to identifying some of the things that we need to do now, and I'm grateful to them. But I have to say to members of this Parliament that this government strategy is bigger and broader than the specialist focus work of the task force. We need to ensure that our own house is in order. We need to join the dots across government, making all the correct connections with our good work in mental health, homelessness, adverse child experiences, the justice system, and of course, tackling poverty and inequality in our communities. And I agree with Neil Findlay that this is indeed a class issue, but I also agree that addiction can affect any family at any time, anywhere in the country. And it is our job in government to lead and to have a razor-like focus on implementation, to work with others, whether it's health and social care bodies, alcohol and drug partnerships, and the third sector, to ensure that funding reaches the front line. And we do indeed need to prevent unplanned discharges from treatment and support and follow up when it does happen. Our folk should never run out of chances for change. Sometimes people need second chances, third chances, fourth chances. We need to stick with people long term. And I'm particularly cognizant that the third sector has a particular role to play in genuine partnership with the statutory sector to be fleet of foot and responsive and help us with outreach services and reach those that are furthest away. There is an urgency and necessity in acting to reduce harms now. I believe in the housing first approach model, but I also believe in the power of residential rehabilitation. The First Minister will make a statement next week laying out how we will achieve a step change in the short, medium and longer term. This will include a commitment to increase the provision of residential rehabilitation, bring our bed numbers up to the European average. This is a new portfolio, and I would never demur from the importance of resources. And I have been clear in discussions with the First Minister and the Finance Secretary that the scale of work should not be underestimated. It will require significant investment over a period of time to affect the change we want. And I will, whether it's current resources or new resources, very much follow the money and be constantly assessing the impact that that has. And if we have to change how we provide funding, well, we will consider that. Because Monica Lennon is right, there must be no wrong door to receiving support. Our response to the global pandemic has demonstrated that rapid change is possible, and there should be no returning to normal where new approaches to care and treatment within prison and the community have worked. I did have the pleasure last week of meeting Peter Kraken, hearing directly about the work he does in Glasgow. We discussed a shared desire for overdose prevention facilities to be made available in Scotland, and I assured him that we would investigate any possible avenue which would allow for the operation of such facilities here. It is vital that we don't close the door to any evidence-based solution, but it is also important that any service we do offer are provided within a safe legal framework for the sake of those who will use the service and for those who work in that service too. But there isn't one solution, there are many. And this is where our courage to debate what works is crucial, because everything we say and do must lead to better informed debate that knocks down stigma, knocks down obstacles to change, and leads to better outcomes for the people that we seek to serve. And we seek to serve those who have been underserved, and to do so for their sake, but also in memory of those who are gone, but not forgotten. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much, Minister. That concludes the debate on members' business on Scotland's drug deaths crisis. As has been indicated to members online, there are no questions to be put at decision time as a result of today's business. I therefore close this meeting.